Hey, Hidden Creek. Today is January 1st, 2023. Happy New Year. A lot of our folks are traveling this weekend, and public transportation isn't running on New Year's Day. And so we've decided to meet online instead of in person today. Church will be back to normal schedule next week, but today we're meeting online, and I want to welcome you, and I want to thank you for being here. The next time that New Year's Day and Christmas Day will fall on a Sunday will be 11 years from now. That seems like forever. And so meeting like this online for Christmas last week and New Year's Day today, it's a rarity. And I know that God will continue to bless us as we meet in this way. And I look forward to the year to come. Let's take a moment to pray, and then we'll begin our service. Jesus, thank you so much for your graciousness and your blessing. Thank you for the new year that's ahead of us. We say, because scripture says, that this is the day the Lord has made and we will rejoice and be glad in it. And we believe too that this year ahead is a year that you've made. It's a gift that you've given to us. And I pray that we would make the most of it as we serve you and as we share the great news of Jesus with the people around us. I pray your blessing on our time together today. Holy Spirit, move in our hearts. Change us to be more like Christ. It's in his name that I pray. Amen. I'm glad you're here.
Sometimes it's not enough to be reminded that Jesus hasn't left you or forgotten you. We need to declare it over ourselves, over others. No matter the season you may find yourself in, no matter the depths of darkness you're wading through, you can join him in declaring the truth that God is light upon your feet, whether or not you can see the next step. That God is your strength, even though the weight of life seems to be crushing you down. And that when your job, your marriage, your relationship, your health feels like it's coming to a dead end, there is only one God that can make dead things live again. These are his promises, and they're the only thing you need to declare over your life. So as you step into this next season, or this next moment, you can declare that God's not done with you. He's just getting started. You can declare that the good work that he has started in you, he will surely complete it. You can declare that the same God that parted the seas goes before you, goes behind you. You can declare these promises over your life, over your family's life, over the people passing on the street. You can declare these truths over every circumstance, over every season of your life. You can declare that every day belongs to him and every new breath belongs to him. Because we have the power of a living God living inside of us. And this is our declaration.
We're in that transitional time between Christmas and the new year. This is one of the natural times that we have to look back and to see how life was. The last year had some unexpected challenges, but some great celebrations. This is the time of year when we're able to stop and evaluate where our relationship is with the Lord. It's also a time where we can look forward to the coming things that 2023 has in store for us. Who knows what surprises are around the corner. But we know this for sure. God has good things in store for us in the year to come. Scripture promises that God is the source of every good and perfect gift. Now, I know this to be true. God's word tells us that it is in James chapter 1, verses 16 to 18. Those are the verses I'd like for us to look at this morning. And so, if you have a Bible, go ahead and grab it, and we're going to go through the book of James, chapter 1, verses 6 to 18 together. And I believe that as we look at these verses, we'll be encouraged in our walk with Christ, and our faith in Him will deepen. Scripture says in James 1, verse 16, 17, and 18, "Don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who doesn't change like the shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, so that we might be a kind of first fruits of all He created." James says here, don't be fooled, don't be tricked. Every good and perfect gift is from God. Now, as you think about gifts, your mind might automatically go to some of the presents that you may have received this Christmas time. James is writing about gifts that are bigger and better than anything that we could receive and unwrap during a Christmas celebration. He's talking about gifts that God has given to us. These gifts enable us to live for God and to serve the people around us. These gifts are the gifts that will carry us through faith in Christ throughout all eternity. So what are these perfect gifts? Well, there are many of them, but let me give you three examples of God's perfect gift to us. The first example is Jesus. That's what the Christmas story is all about. God loving us so much that He gave His Son so that through His death and through His resurrection, we might experience redemption and forgiveness, the forgiveness of our sins. A second perfect gift that God gives to us when we place our faith in Christ is the Holy Spirit. God's word tells us that the Holy Spirit of God comes to live inside of us, and the Holy Spirit is a seal on our lives that we have placed our faith and trust in Christ, and that we experience everything that Jesus has for us. A third gift that we can count on, that God has given to us, a perfect gift, is the gift of eternal life. Now, none of these gifts can be earned. They're all gifts of grace that God has given to us. None of us deserve these gifts, but through simple faith in Christ, Jesus forgives us, His Holy Spirit lives in us, and we're promised eternal life. Now, James describes God, our Father, in this way. He calls Him the Father of heavenly lights. We don't have to look too far to see and experience the greatness, the wonder, the majesty of God. James calls our attention to the lights in the sky, both lights that are there day and night. The sun, Scripture says, God gave to rule over the day, and the moon he gave to rule over the night. We see the sun, the moon, the stars, the planets as they wander across the night sky. And we know there's something bigger and better and greater than us. God's fingerprint is written all over creation. And James says that God, the giver of perfect gifts, is the Father of heavenly lights. Think about our own sun for a moment. The power that's wrapped up into the sun, our closest star. Its power, its energy can't be calculated. Scientists try to figure out how much energy and power the sun displays or produces in a second, and it's an astronomical number. So when we look at our own sun, we see that there is a huge amount of energy wrapped up in that sun, in that star. That energy is produced when gravity from the sun's great mass crush hydrogen atoms so that they're fused, creating helium atoms. Boy, that's a lot of science right there. When that happens, heat and light is produced, and that heat radiates throughout our solar system. Scientists guess that the sun is 200 million degrees. Oh, that's really hot. Now think about all the energy that's wrapped up in our own sun, and then think about the stars in the Milky Way galaxy. Scientists estimate that there are 100,000 million stars in the Milky Way galaxy. Imagine the energy of all of those stars combined. It blows my mind to think of it. And think about all the stars in the universe. Again, scientists guess at what the number might be, and they say that it's 200 billion trillion stars, give or take a few. That is a lot of energy. Scripture tells us that God is the Father, the source, the creator of all of those heavenly lights. This is the God who loves us, the God who pours out his gifts upon us. Now, our God, he's not a chaotic God. He's a God of order, Scripture tells us. And this God of order provides for us stability in life. James says that God doesn't change like the shifting shadows. Shifting shadows, they're unreliable. The stable, unchanging light of God revealed to us through Jesus the Messiah is the only stable and reliable source of light and life. Our world is filled with all kinds of false lights that produce shifting shadows that disorient us, that keep us from knowing what our next steps should be. I like playing games with my grandchildren. And one of the games that we've played recently is called Shadows in the Forest. It's a board game, and on the board game are tiny cardboard trees, and the characters in the game hide in the shadows of the trees. It's kind of like a hide-and-seek for ages 3 and up, which makes it a game that I can play. And the cardboard trees, the characters, and then there's a battery-powered lantern. Now, the lantern moves different places across the board. And because of that, the shadows on the board begin to shift and the character isn't quite sure where to hide. The world that we live in is like that. Shifting shadows all the time. We don't know what can be counted on, what changes might take place. Scripture tells us that God, our Father, doesn't change like the shifting shadows. He is a reliable constant in the universe. And he's faithful to us. That's a promise that God's word gives to us. It's one that's reliable. The God that we have is this great giver of gifts who is stable and reliable in all he does. And because of that, we know that he is faithful to the things that he says. Scripture tells us in James 1, 16 to 18, that he chooses to give us new birth. Now, he does this through the person of Jesus Christ. He gives us new birth through the word of truth. Scripture tells us that Jesus is the word of God. Jesus says about himself that he's the way, the truth, and the life, and that no one comes to the Father except through him. Jesus, this giver of life, is God's great gift to us. The word of truth is also the message that Jesus gives to us that we carry, that through Jesus there is redemption. There is the forgiveness of sin. God chooses to give us this kind of new life. Now, the verse goes on to say that he does this so that we might be a kind of first fruits of all creation. Well, what does that mean? What are the first fruits? Well, in ancient Israel, the practice, according to God's law, was to take the first fruits, the first of the harvest, and present it to the Lord. It was a way of thanking God for providing for them, and a way of saying, God, we're giving you the first and the best of what we have, and we're trusting you to take care of us, our family, and our land. Now, Scripture tells us that we are a kind of first fruits of all creation. Think about this gift of life that Jesus gives. The first century Christians were the first to experience this new life that Jesus came to give. They were the first believers, the first Christians. And when James writes, he's saying to them, you are on display as the best of what God has to offer. You have received this new life, this new way of living through Jesus. You are a first fruits, and there's the implication that generations to come of believers would look back and see that they were the first to receive this good news, this message of truth that comes through Jesus. Well, what about us? 2,000 years later, Scripture tells us that when we place our faith in Christ, the same energy, the same power that raised Christ from the dead radiates throughout us and transforms us so that we may grow in ever-increasing glory into the image of Christ. We too are first fruits displayed for all creation that redemption and life has come through Jesus our Lord. Your life is on display. Now, when Jesus came to earth, he came to die not for planets, not for stars, not for rocks or plants or animals. He came to die for people like you and me. He died, Scripture says, for all humanity. When we place our faith in Jesus, we step into the new life that he offers. And that's great news. Jesus allows us to be examples and be witnesses of the change that he brings in our lives. We're on display, not just for the people around us, but Scripture says, for all creation. You and I are some of the first fruits, the best that God has to display to everything else he created. Jesus died for you and me. In our lives, we see the good and the perfect gift of God's mercy and love shown toward us through Jesus. You and I have seen God's faithfulness in the year and in the years that have gone by, and we see his faithfulness to us today. God has good plans in store for your future. He has good things in store for you in 2023. Now, some of that goodness might be wrapped up in pain and suffering, but we know that God promises that every good and perfect gift is from him. These gifts come down from the Father of heavenly lights, who doesn't change like the shifting shadows. He chooses to give us new birth through the word of truth so that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he's created.
This is my father's world. To my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks, of trees, of skies and seas, his hand the wonders wrought. This is my father's world. Oh, and let me never forget that though the wrong seems often so strong, God is the ruler, yeah. This is my father's word. Oh, the battle is not done, 'cause Jesus who died will be satisfied, and earth and heaven will be one. It's Jesus who died will be satisfied.
Paul writes to the Ephesians, chapter 6, verse 22, "Peace to the brothers and sisters, and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to all who love the Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love." May you be blessed in the year to come as you look for opportunities to serve the people around you in the name of Jesus. May He give you the words to say and the things to do to show the people around you His great love.